Hi, this is Dr. A. In this last video in our basics of pediatric testing, we're going to look at renal function and hematology in the pediatric population. Okay, so the creatinine, the normal range for newborns is going to be 0.3 to 1.0 milligrams per DL. So that in newborns, infants, children, this lower limit of normal is lower than in adults. So infants is going to be 0.2 to 0.4, and you can see this upper limit of normal is really low here too. Then in children, it's going to be 0.3 to 0.7, and adolescents 0.5 to 1.5, where here the upper limit of normal kind of comes up. And then for the adult female, it's 0.5 to 1.0 milligrams per deciliter, and in males, 0.6 to 1.2 milligrams per deciliter. And so, what you have to just remember is creatinine is related to muscle mass, and obviously newborn and infants don't have a high muscle mass, and children have a smaller one, but they start acquiring more of it, and then in adolescents they gain more muscle, especially males. So creatinine is a useful indicator of renal function, and it can be used to estimate the glomerular filtration rate, or how well the kidneys are working. Compared to adults, of course, pediatric patients have a lower muscle mass per unit of body size, and because the production of creatinine is dependent on muscle mass, that is why they have lower normal values than the adult population. So for the hematology values, let's first look at the erythrocytes, or the like red cell portion of the CBC. So compared to adults, newborns have higher hemoglobin and hematocrit values, but those will start to decrease in the first week of life, and they reach their lowest point around 2 to 3 months of age. So this drop is called the physiologic anemia of infancy. Do not need to worry about it or treat it. They will recover and level off. The higher HNH values, HNH meaning hemoglobin hematocrit at birth, are due to the low arterial PO2 environment in utero. So if you remember, when a baby is inside the womb, they are not breathing oxygen. Their lungs are full of amniotic fluid, and they're getting oxygen from the placenta, from what mom breathes, and it is definitely not at the PO2 concentration that is at the lung interface of the mom and then the baby after it's born. So that lower PO2 environment then stimulates erythropoietin production, because that's what it's supposed to do. And then at birth, they take their first full breath of air, and oxygen hits their blood. And this oxygen level significantly increases with the first few breaths, and then that will start to down-regulate the erythropoietin production, and over the next few weeks, you can see the levels of red cells is going to start dropping. Incidentally, giving infants whole cow's milk can cause iron deficiency anemia, and then actually cause true anemia to develop. So let's look at this table as a summary. We're going to concentrate on, for example, newborn. So a few days after they're born, their hemoglobin can be as high as 18.5 on average, and with hematocrit of 56%, which is much higher than males that are, you know, adult males, which there are 47. The average is 47, and so their average here is 56. So it's almost like 10 units higher, right? And then you can see as the weeks progress, we get 1 week, 2 weeks, a month, it drops. It goes from 56% to 54% to 51% to 43% to 35%. And this is where we have that physiologic anemia of infancy. That's, you know, the drop in the hematocrit, and then the hemoglobin is going to go from 18.5 to 17.5 to 16.5 to 14 to 11.5. So this is the lowest. And then it's going to start climbing back up between 6 months and 2 years. It's going to go up to 36, and in 2 to 6 years, it goes up on average to 37% for the hematocrit. And then 6 to 12 is going to be 40. And then we start splitting female and male, because females will always have a lower amount of red cells and a lower hemoglobin and hematocrit than males. And if you ask why, it's because of testosterone. So males have higher testosterone levels and higher muscle mass, and so they have that drives a higher amount of red cells, and so therefore they have higher hemoglobin and hematocrit values than females. So as regards to the white blood cell count, for a newborn at birth, the normal range is going to be 9.0 to 30 times 10 to the 3, so 1,000 cells per square millimeter, millimeter cubed. Sorry about that. So 30 is three times the upper limit of normal in adults. So that would be 30,000 cells per cubic millimeter. And so they have a much, when they're first born, have a much, much higher white count than your average adult. At 2 weeks, it starts dropping some. So it's 5.0 to 21.0 thousands of cells per cubic millimeter. At 3 months, it's 6.0 to 18. So the lower end of normal is getting close to what it is for adults. That upper end of normal is still almost twice as much as what you would expect in adults. From 6 months old to 6 years, it's 6.0 to 15.0, so it's dropping a little bit more. And from 7 to 12 years is 4.5 to 13.5 thousand cells per cubic millimeter. And then your normal adult range is somewhere around 5 to 10 thousand cells per cubic millimeter. And so why is it simply from newborn until they become adults? Children are developing their immune system, and they're definitely more prone to infections, and so they simply need more white cells around, and so there are more white cells for in a normal healthy child than there is in adult. So in adults, a high white count indicates infection, and in newborns and infants, a systemic bacterial infection can cause the white count to be high, low, or normal. Okay, so why would it cause in adults it to go up and then newborns to go down? Well, initially they're responsible for it to go up, but they have less of a storage pool and less of a reserve, so it could get depleted very quickly and then cause a drop. And so if an infant presents with neutropenia, with not enough white cells or a low white count, it could be significant of in indicating a potential bacterial infection, potential sepsis in a newborn. And then in the white cell differential, from newborn to about up to 5 to 6 years of age, the predominant white cell is going to be your lymphocyte. Well, it makes sense if you think of their immune system is learning and which white cell is responsible for adaptive immunity and antibody production. It's the lymphocyte. And then after this period of life, then the neutrophils become the predominant white cell, and that is so until death, till the end of life. So this is in adults, and in children that are 6 years or older, the neutrophil is predominant. So neutrophils, as a reminder, they are the white cell that will be increased in bacterial infection. And so they're really good at destroying cellular invaders such as bacteria. So there you go. So that wraps up our hematology values and stuff, and it also wraps up our basics of pediatric testing. So I appreciate your attention. Thank you.